fake and we could see right through it.
My brother cries because he's scared of Santa, but I'm not.
What kinds of things do you like to do in the snow?
Play in the snow.
I like to make snowmen.
Make snow angels.
Slide down hills.
Snowball fights.
And then I like to skate, but it's really hard. I can't even do it.
Whose birthday is on Christmas?
Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus is.
Santa's. I mean, Jesus.
And where was Jesus born?
In a tent.
In a stable.
At a hospital.
In Bethlehem.
In Oklahoma.
What kind of animals were there?
Sheep and cows, horses,
chickens, camels, pigs, elephants,
bunnies and rabbits,
zebras, dogs and kitties.
Why do other people get presents on Jesus' birthday?
Because they've been good.
Well, they gave presents to him when he was born, and we give gifts to each other.
Because Jesus was the gift from God.
What do you think is Jesus' favorite part of Christmas?
Just seeing people happy.
See how everyone's being kind to one another.
Probably the missions for all the homeless people.
If you could give Jesus a present, what would you give him?
A puppy dog.
A snowball.
A little bear, and he loves it.
I'll give him all my toys.
My love.
My heart.
Everything I had.
Why do you think Jesus came to live with us?
Because he loves everybody the most.
Because he wanted us to be good and not bad.
He's God's son, and that was what God wanted him to do.
And that way he could fix out all the problems that were happening.
He felt like we were more important than him. I think he loves us very much.
Why is Christmas so special?
Jesus was born on that day.
Because you share it with your friends and family.
It's a day where we can spend time and we get to give presents to other people. It's about sharing. We get to praise Jesus.
I love it.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
What's your
What did the cows at the manger say to baby Jesus in the hay? Moo, 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 moo. Baby Jesus, we love you. What did the sheep at the manger say to baby Jesus in the hay? Ba, 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 ba. Baby Jesus, we love you. Jesus was born on Christmas Day. Mary laid him in the hay. So little boys and girls may pray. Jesus, Jesus, baby Jesus, we love you. What did the donkeys at the manger say to baby Jesus in the hay? Hee-haw, hee-haw, baby Jesus, we love you. Jesus was born on Christmas Day. Mary laid him in the hay. So little boys and girls may pray. Jesus, Jesus, baby Jesus, we love you. Moo, moo, ba, ba, hee-haw. Jesus, baby Jesus, we love you.
Good job, you guys. That was so awesome. What are you most excited for Christmas? Can you tell me? What are you most excited for?
Making a snowman.
Making a snowman. What are you most excited for?
Santa Claus to come for presents.
Oh, how about you? Are you excited for Christmas? You are? And what are you most excited for?
This blue.
And you were worried she'd have a hard time on the stage. How about you? What are you most excited for? You're thinking about it. Do you want to tell me what you're excited for? No. How about you?
I want a bike for Christmas.
Oh, she wants a bike for Christmas. Can we give our kids another great big hand? So we have, let's see, a switch here. We have one more tradition, and we are going to just invite the kids to sing happy birthday to Jesus, right? Because it's Jesus' birthday. And then at the end of the song, we'll blow out the candles. You guys ready? Okay, let's hear it. Okay, you're going to follow Miss Carice right that way. Great job. Wow, you guys all look so cute, too. Got a birthday cake for Jesus. I love it. On Christmas Eve, when you come back, another one of our Mohawk Valley Church traditions is every year on Christmas Eve, we give every family a gift bag with everything you need to make your very own birthday cake for Jesus. So you'll want to make sure you come back for that. Pastor Caleb is coming up. Pastor Caleb is our youth pastor. And I have to tell, you guys need to give yourselves a hand this morning. And I'll tell you why in a minute. Give yourselves a hand. A couple weeks ago, Pastor Caleb and Bree gave you an opportunity to purchase cookie trays to help our teenagers go on a missions trip to LA. And you bought over 40 cookie trays. Isn't that awesome? Way to go. So they do have a few more available for purchase. If you're interested, you can grab one of those on your way out.
Yes, we have 10 extra first come, first serve. So just a little push out there. It's $35 a tray. So make sure you guys purchase. It does take our kids to LA. So I have an object lesson for you today. So in Matthew 5, on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says we are the light of the world in a city on a hill. And so we have to shine our light to the world. But there is one thing that doesn't like the light, and it is the world. So the world tries to put our light out. But as you can see, when we're not of the world, they can't put our light out. Yeah, I had the same reaction when I first saw it. So it says that we are the light on the hill in the city on a hill. But when we are not a part of the world, they can't put our light out. There is only one person and one way that can put our light out, and that's ourselves. When we ourselves conform to the world, that's when our light gets put out by the world. So there is only one person who can do that. That's us. When we conform to the world's standards and conform, that's when we put our light out. In Romans 12:2, it says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that is by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable." So when we transform our mind, that's when God uses us, and that's when we continually light our light and go to our neighbors and our coworkers, and we spread the gospel, and we are the light of the world. But we need to make sure every day we renew our mind and continue to keep our light lit instead of conforming to the world and falling into it and burning our light out. So now we have a video. So if you want to point in your direction of the screen and showing us that Jesus is truly the light of the world.
brilliant light pierced the darkness on that first Christmas night. It wasn't the immense star so bright that intrigued experts of the night sky to follow it. It wasn't even the multitude of angelic messengers with a light so intense, so radiant, it frightened brave shepherds to fall to their knees. No, this light was far greater, more powerful than every star and every sun. This light was a baby, a tiny newborn wrapped in cloth, lying in a manger where animals feed. A baby named Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Because Jesus was a gift for each one of us, and he arrived with a purpose, to shine light into all dark places. You see, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the light. A light that shows us there is no place you can go that can escape God's love. No dark corner where his love cannot find you. A light that has the power to cut through any darkness, to calm the most anxious thoughts, and to fill every heart with unspeakable joy. There is a light that shines brightly in the darkness, and his name is Jesus, light of the world.
Today we are celebrating the true light of the world. And I want to invite all of our MV kids to come on up and join me on the stage this morning. They have been practicing and preparing a few different things for you. So they are going to sing for us. Come on up, guys. They are going to sing, but before they sing, they're actually going to teach us something. How many of you know our kids have something to teach us? Amen? And we want to give them every opportunity we can for God to use them in ministry. This is important. This is more than just entertainment for the church. This is allowing God to use our kids and be a part of what God is teaching us as adults. So they're going to teach us their memory verse that they've been working on. So we need good crowd participation for this, all right? So what they're going to do is tell us the first line. And then, church, we are going to very boldly and loudly to encourage them, repeat after them, to learn this month's memory verse, right? Are you guys ready? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's hear it.
Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
6 weeks. They've done awesome. So we have been working and doing hand motions and singing loud, and Miss Emma took a little solo there. Great job, Emma Decker. Woo! You did awesome. These kids are such a blast to work with, and I've been telling them that you get to play a little part in sharing Jesus with other people. That's what you're doing up here. It's not just about, and we learned last month about overcoming some fear, and when I first brought this to the kids, they were a little like, we're going to be on the stage. Oh my gosh. And I was like, but we know that God helps us overcome fear, and this is one of those things where if God can help you overcome your fear, you get to play a part in sharing his light with other people. So if I can have one of my MV kids come out here with me, he's going to help me out. He also happens to be my youngest. Are you coming? Today we wanted to focus in a little bit on one aspect of the Christmas story. I'm going to ask Oliver a couple questions, okay? Are you ready? Okay. So, Oliver, what do you think of when you think of a star, which you are clearly dressed as for us today?
Twinkle, twinkle, little star.
Right. Twinkle, twinkle, little star. Do you guys know that one? Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Right. There's a song. Is there anything else you think of?
Wish upon a star.
Right, you can wish upon a star. Have you guys heard that one? Starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. You guys remember that one? Little nursery rhyme, right? And where do you find a star usually at Christmas time?
On a tree.
Tree, right. We top the tree with a star or maybe an angel, right? Right. You did a great job, Oliver. Thanks for helping me out. You can go back there, okay? They'll help you unstar yourself. So, how many of you guys top your tree with a star? And how many of you top it? Let's see. A star first. Who tops their tree with a star? I know we have bows now, too, but I left that one out. All right. Who tops it with an angel? Okay, we're a little split, a little diversified, and probably some of you have bows or no topper at all because things are trendy. But typically, we top a tree with a star or an angel. And if we think about the story of Jesus' birth, those are two things that helped lead people to Jesus, right? So when we look at the tree on top of the star on top of our tree, we think about the wise men who followed the bright shining star all the way to our newborn king, right? We oftentimes place that star on top of the tree and we forget. We forget why it's there at all. It's just part of our decorations, right? It's just a tradition. How many of you guys have a tradition of somebody in your family special places the star on top of the tree? That's another tradition, but we often forget what that star even represents. In Revelation 16:23, it says, Jesus says himself, I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you these things for the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. He is the star. He is the light. And while our nursery rhyme about wishing on a star is fun, we can do that. There's nothing wrong with wish upon a star. We know that ultimately our hope and our joy and our peace is found in that morning star, that bright and morning star that came to us. We are also called to be a bright, shining star, showing people the love of Jesus through us. Jesus' love shines through us like we are a bright, shining star ourselves. So letting his light shine through us, we have the opportunity to lead people to Jesus, just like the star that shone that night. Not just on Christmas, but every single day.
Aren't our kids great? Didn't they do a great job? Come on, let's give our kids another hand. Thank you, Brandy, for pouring into our kids week in and week out. Well, we've been talking about the light, the star. And for those of you that don't know, I was born and raised in a little town in northern Ontario in Canada. And we would go camping pretty much every summer growing up. And because we lived so far north, we would often, not all the time, but often we'd go out camping. But we did like real camping, not a trailer, not, you know, a park. Like we went to an island with no electricity. We put up a tent, and that's how we camped. And because we're out on this island, out on the water, we would several times, I remember seeing the northern lights. Anybody see the northern lights before? I mean, it is just... It's amazing. It's just so great to see, and depending upon the day and how clear it was, would depend upon how vibrant the colors were that we would see. But man, I can remember laying out on a rock, staring up at the sky on a summer's night, and just watching the colors dance across the sky. And it was just such a great, great moment, and really it's just amazing to see if you ever get the chance. But you know, there's a long history of light guiding the people of God. And if you go back to Exodus, in Exodus we were told that as Moses led the Israelites out of Egypt, that God guided Moses by a fire by night. So it was a fire by night. It was a light that led Moses through the wilderness. And then in Joshua, you see where Joshua prayed, and actually the sun, which is obviously the light, the sun stood still for Joshua to win a battle. So we see all throughout Scripture different ways and that God has used light to guide the people of God. And then we read in Psalms chapter 119, verses 105, it says, "Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." And man, I've found that so true in my life, that God's word, it truly has been a lamp unto my feet. Anytime I've been confused, anytime I've wondered where to go, what to do, God's word has always lit my path. He is our light. So it's not a surprise when God was getting ready to bring forth his son through Mary, that he threw up this supercharged light into the sky to guide those wise men to where Jesus was going to be born. And we read this in Matthew chapter 2, verse 9. And we read where it says, "The star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was." It stopped over the place where the child was. It was a star that lit up the sky to guide those wise men. And the Bible tells us that the star rested over that stable where Jesus was born. That star, that light, it was their guide. It guided them. Let me ask you today, what guides you? What is guiding your life today? Because here's the thing, is what guides you will determine where you end up. So you have to ask yourself, what is guiding me? Is my career guiding me? Is my family guiding me? Is money guiding me? What is it that guides you? Because what's guiding you will determine where you end up today. I want to submit to you that there's no greater book that could guide our lives than God's Word. It truly is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And is Jesus guiding you today? What guides you will determine where you end up. And who here use Google Maps to get around? All right? And my wife proudly raises her hand. We've been lived here for a little over 5 years, and going to Walmart will press in. Walmart and Maps will guide her to Walmart. Guide her, like, it doesn't matter if she's been there 100 times. She will use those maps. Me, it's funny, I was taking my daughter, was it you, Ivy, or Addy? I can't remember. Last week, I was taking them somewhere I hadn't been before, and I used maps to get there. Or no, it was Addy. I used maps to get there, and I'm like, I don't need this to get home. I drove there. I know how to get back. Worship team, you can go ahead and come on back. And sure enough, I was like, the first turn was wrong. And I'm looking around like, yeah, this doesn't look familiar. Man, I have to use these stinking maps. Like, I don't want to use it. But what guides you is going to determine. I was guiding myself, but guess what? I didn't know where I was going, so I ended up lost. And I think that's what happens to a lot of people spiritually. They think, I know where I'm going. It's okay, I don't need this book. It's old. It's, you know, it's kind of old-fashioned. And I don't need God. I know where I'm going. But we end up lost. I want to tell you today that if you find yourself lost, far from Him, He's always one prayer away. That there is grace, there is forgiveness, that God loves you more than you will know. You see, in John 8, chapter 12, it says, when Jesus spoke again to the people, He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Man, that star was the light that led those wise men to Jesus. But now, it's Jesus that leads us. Does Jesus lead your life today? Because He declared, I am the light of the world. And when we follow Jesus, the Bible says, we will never walk in darkness. Now, never walking in darkness doesn't mean that you're not going to have hard times. It doesn't mean that you're not going to have trials. It doesn't mean that you're not going to have adversity. What it means is that I will not walk in darkness. See, when you're walking through hard times, but you have your eyes on Jesus, everything changes. It may be hard. It may get lonely. But you will always, always end up at the right destination. When you have your eyes fixed on Jesus and you allow God's word to light your path. Jesus is the light that we're to follow. And His word will light your path as is lit so many paths in here. Maybe you find yourself at a crossroads today and you're not sure what to do. Or maybe if you're honest with yourself today, be like, you know what? I've kind of been leading myself. I've been kind of guiding myself through life. I want to give you an opportunity. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I want everyone to go ahead and bow your head and close your eyes. And if you'd say, Pastor, I don't have a relationship with Jesus. Maybe I know about Him. Maybe I know some things about Christianity. I know about God's Word, but I don't have that personal relationship. With every head bowed and every eye closed, that if you would say, Pastor, that's me, I just want you to slip your hand up and I count to three. One, two, three. Go ahead and slip your hand up and say, you know what, that's me. I want to have a relationship with Jesus. Amen. I see that hand. Anybody else all across this place? Just want to take a moment. See that hand. Amen. I want you to go ahead and stand to your feet. I want to pray over you and pray for those that raise their hand. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. Lord, I thank you, God, that you sent your son Jesus, Lord, to be born of the virgin. Lord, as we celebrate your birth, we understand that you were born to die. And for those that raise their hand that say, I want a relationship with Jesus, we know that you are faithful and your word says you come and you make them a new creation in you. We thank you and praise you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a reminder for those that raise their hand, man, we would love to connect with you. If you could fill out that connect card in the seat back in front of you and just mark it on there, made a commitment to Christ. We just love a way to follow up with you, maybe get some resources in your hand. If you're looking for a church, we would love to be that church to partner with you, because this is a journey. Amen, church. This is a journey walking through life as a believer. And again, this Saturday, we have two Christmas Eve services, one at 3:30 and one at 5 o'clock. We know this place is going to be full, so you want to come here, get here early. But take this card. It was on your seat when you got in. Invite somebody. But more than invite, bring somebody with you to church. It's going to be a phenomenal, phenomenal service with special music and message and candlelit. You're not going to want to miss it. You want to bring your entire family. All right, and then next Sunday, it's Christmas Day. We're going to have an online-only service. You're going to hear a special message online from Susie and I right in our home, and we hope that you tune in at 9 a.m. But, man, we can't wait to see you this Christmas Eve at 3:30 and 5, and we're going to go ahead and sing one last Christmas carol together. Then Susie will be back to close. Let's sing this together.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem.
Right now. Oh, come.